Hello everyone, I am Dr. Syed, Consultant Pulmonologist at Narayana, Udalya. Welcome all the viewers on the occasion of World COPD Day. Today we have in our panel Dr. Ranganatha Ramanjinaya.
Hello.
The head of the Department of Pulmonology at Narayana, Udalya. And Dr. Sagar, who is a Consultant Pulmonologist at Narayana, Udalya. We'll have interactive discussion on COPD. So, I would like Dr. Ranganathan to enlighten us about what is this COPD. We are having a COPD day. Why does this COPD entity deserves a day? So, Dr. Ranganathan, what is your opinion on this COPD?
Dr. Syed, COPD is a condition which actually affects our lungs, which is a chronic disorder which is due to the inflammation of our airways. And the causes could be very varied, like a noxious smoke or a pollution, which we are going to discuss further later. And the patients who is affected with this manifest as a chronic cough and breathlessness and walking and many other symptoms. We will discuss further, but it can be, it is a treatable one, and more importantly, it's a preventable disease.
So, Dr. Ranganathan, most of the time, what we know that, you know, every breathlessness, all these years, we thought it is asthma. Now, what do you think, how do you think it is different from asthma in any other diseases?
It's a good question. Actually, many patients who cough for a long time are having a breathlessness. It is, some say it is breathless asthma, some say it is COPD. But the differentiating these two diseases is very important in terms of in terms of treating it well, and also the outcomes are way different from one another. So if you look at, to say a few points on this, asthma is a disease which is, it has an early onset and it's actually completely reversible disease. But COPD is actually a late onset disease and it is secondary to a permanent damage of the lung, secondary to something like smoking, where the treatment options are limited, where the prevention takes an upper hand rather than the treatment here in this condition.
So how many people do you think across the globe are suffering from this entity called COPD? And what do you think is the burden of this disease?
COPD is a huge problem. So if you look at one statistics, which is WHO statistics, which is present time we have around 250 million people living with COPD. And it's about, in India alone, we have 1 million deaths in 2016 because of COPD. On average, around 5 to 6% of the population suffer from the COPD.
So it is said that it is the third largest killer in the globe.
Right.
I mean, how true it is?
Yeah, presently it is around, fourth leading cause of death. And it is projected to be third leading cause in coming years. And in India alone, it has actually 13% of all the deaths in India is secondary to the COPD.
Dr. Sagar, what do you think are the causes for COPD?
So there are many causes for COPD. Few to enumerate are, the one of the important genetic risk factor is alpha 1 antitrypsin deficiency, which is less commonly diagnosed in India because of lack of infrastructure in many of the government hospitals and few private sector hospitals also, and will be diagnosed only in research institutes or very well equipped tertiary care centers. And other common risk factors are like post-infective, like TB is very rampant in India as we all know, and the patients who are treated with tuberculosis after during the course of a post-infective period, they might develop a COPD. It is also called as post-tubercular COPD or TOPD. Okay, and it is very important for other doctors to diagnose it and treat it, and awareness among the doctors about this condition is very minimal. And the other more common causes of COPD are like traffic pollution, which is very important risk factors in metros. Even though people who don't smoke get exposed to this risk factor very frequently, especially in cities like Bangalore. And the smoking, not only the person who smokes, but the person who stands beside them, that smoke, what they inhale is called as secondhand smoke. Even they are at risk factor if they get exposed for a long term. And other risk factors are like indoor air pollution. We think that agarbatti, camphor, dhoop and all are very good smokes because we use it in the some religious activities and all. But when it is used on a long term basis and higher proportions, then it will certainly affect the lungs. Few of our patients are the priests in Hindu temples and all who conduct homa and havans very frequently, and they come after many years with symptoms of COPD. When we evaluate, and they'll get the treatment for COPD. And other risk factor, one of the important risk factor in rural India is biofuel
burning wood
and coal and all. So especially females who get exposed to this for many years while cooking, they also suffer from COPD. And occupational exposure like industrial chemicals and the people who live in industrial areas, they also get affected. And few other occupations like farming, like chronic exposure to certain dusts of
cotton dust
and all, they also cause COPD.
So Dr. Sagar, when you have a patient in front of you, when he has breathlessness, when do you think you should start suspecting that patient is having COPD?
So the patient who comes with a history of prolonged cough, usually the patients with COPD will come with history of at least 2 years or more than 2 years history of cough, sputum production. And usually the sputum production in patients with a bronchitic subgroup of COPD will have early morning cough with expectoration. And also breathlessness history will be a prolonged one, like more than 2 years or more of breathlessness history will be there. Wheezing is one of the important symptoms of COPD patients. So few patients will have with very severe COPD will have breathlessness even to do simple tasks of day-to-day activities like going to washroom or dressing and undressing will be very difficult for them. With patients who come with this history, we should suspect COPD in them and subject them to specific investigation like spirometry, chest x-ray, and if very much necessary, we should go ahead and do a CT scan of the thorax. And also one of the important history we should take from these patients is, as we already talked about, the exposure history like smoking or passive smoking and occupational exposures we should ask for.
So is there any age limit where you suspect, you know, this patient is having COPD, this patient is having asthma? Do you have something like that?
As Dr. Ranganatha has already mentioned, usually asthma is a very early onset disease, and COPD is usually in patients with late onset. So, but there is no clear-cut distinction in age groups, because patients with genetic disorders like alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency and all might present early. So like with history and clinical examination and also other investigation, we can clearly classify whether they are asthma or COPD. But suspicion of COPD is important with history.
One of the important thing which has been looked at in terms of age is, generally it is used the 40 as a cutoff. And if a person presents you with symptoms and signs suggestive of COPD and the age is less than 40, it is mandated to check for the alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency. Others, usually the COPD people present after 40, and they usually have the history of exposure which you have to look into in terms of smoking or the pollution or the previous infection which have damaged the lungs sufficiently. In the background, this history and the more than 40, we should be looking for COPD.
So Dr. Ranganathan, Dr. Sagar mentioned about few investigations. Do you have any specific test where we can tell, are there any guidelines which says that, you know, you have to follow this test, you have to do this test at a particular time to diagnose him as COPD? And what are you taking into consideration when you are labeling a patient as COPD?
To label a person as COPD, the definitive test which is recommended by all the global organizations which gives the guidelines to treat the COPD disease is spirometry, where we have, which is a simple test where you have to blow into computer where your volumes are checked and see the pattern whether the there is a limitation to your airflow. And we have a specific value value called 0.7, where the FE1 by FEC ratio of 0.7, it's a diagnostic of COPD. And sometimes it is not straightforward. Sometimes you have a normal spirometry, but all the features suggestive of COPD is there. Then additional investigation like chest X-ray, COPD, as mentioned by Dr. Sagar, had to be used to make a diagnosis of COPD.
So I think it is our experience when you are doing a PFT, it is very difficult for a patient to understand how exactly he has to done, and patient requires some kind of an effort. So do you think, are there any alternatives for this maneuver and alternative test to diagnose COPD?
Right, it's a good question, Dr. Syed. There is, when it comes to spirometry, there is a lot of limitations as of now, which as a globally, we're all working towards kind of eliminating this limitation. The one is widespread availability of a spirometry, which is not the case. It's not like a ECG, it's there everywhere where we can do the test as the patient walks in. It needs a certain training by the person who is performing. It is subjective and the effort dependent, and it needs a person who is patient and who understands the test and does that. There are some newer tests, what we call IOS, and those kind of a test where the effort involved in diagnosing is less, and the human it doesn't depend on a person who is doing the technique. So it is easier tests and are more sensitive to pick up
this kind of quality. You don't require any effort, you mean to say. It is only the normal breathing pattern
It's a normal breathing pattern where there is no forced blowing and certain way of blowing is not there in that.
So once you have diagnosed that this patient is having COPD, what exactly do you do? So most of us are aware that, you know, when you have breathing problem, especially asthma, they go on inhaler. There is a lot of social stigma regarding this, using inhalers. What is your say on this? Do they have to use these inhalers? Can they get rid of these inhalers? Are there any treatment apart from inhalers?
Yeah, it's a good question, and the answer has to be elaborate here. So it all depends on the stage at which you diagnose the COPD. So we divide the handling the COPD in terms of the three things. The one, how symptomatic the patient is, and a patient has to be given a symptomatic benefit for him to feel better and have trust in the treatment and continuous treatment. Second, then the COPD in its natural history has a lot of acute attacks where the patient's condition acutely worsens and sometimes we may have to admit them. So if a person who has an advanced COPD, where we call it a stage 3 or stage 4 thing, an average 2 to 3 times you get hospitalized because of these acute exacerbations, which puts a lot of burden on the society and the healthcare budget, also on the patients himself. This acute exacerbation actually causes the progression of disease further. So it is an important aspect of the COPD which we have to handle. The third aspect of handling the COPD is, so the risk factor of COPD, as already mentioned, is smoking, air pollution and other infections, which is also a risk factor of many other diseases in our body, something like heart diseases, what we call is coronary artery disease, and a patient at the same age where he develops hypertension and diabetes with an associated hereditary risk factors. So many times the patient comes to your COPD but is symptomatically worse, or his condition is very poor because of the contribution from these diseases, which also needs to be given, need to be evaluated simultaneously and address them properly. So it depends on three things: symptomatic benefit, treatment towards the symptoms. Second one is to handle the exacerbation properly and taking care of the comorbid conditions. So if you look at the symptoms are secondary to is bronchoconstrictions. The mainstay of treatment here depends on providing a bronchodilator, which is long acting and takes care of symptoms. And depending on the stage we try to treat is we need to apply the infection prevent strategy and control his symptoms well. And there are conditions which predisposes person to an acute exacerbation. Try to address them so that try to minimize the number of exacerbation. When actually patient presents to you with an exacerbation, he needs the systemic steroids. He also needs antibiotics. Sometimes the hospitalization where he is, may have to be mechanically ventilated. Simultaneously, we have to take care of the comorbid conditions, which I have already mentioned in these kind of things.
You spoke about steroids, Dr. Ranganath. I think public has a lot of stigma about steroids. Like, you know, when you tell that, you know, this has a steroid, this inhaler has a steroid, they panic. Oh, should I take really steroids? What do you think the message you want to give to the people? What is the role of the steroids in exacerbation? As you said, we use systemic steroids, inhaled steroids. What is the message you want to give?
I understand this problem completely, Syed. This is a common question which we always face, and in a day in and day out, we keep addressing this problem. So basically, the conditions where we use steroids in two conditions, it is the asthma and COPD. So the role of steroid is more so in asthma rather than COPD, where the inflammation is less. It's more of a permanent damage in asthma, which is more of an inflammation which needs a higher dose of steroids. For the long-term management of steroids, these conditions, we need steroids, but what we do is we deliver the steroids in such a way that it doesn't cause the systemic side effects, like in what we were already discussing about the role of inhaler. So there is a misconception in the society that the inhaler therapy is for the terminal diseases. Going for an inhaler causes an addiction, and if a patient is on inhaler, he is not be able to get off the inhaler, and it is given for a late stage disease. It's actually, these are all myths. Basically, when the disease is milder or early stages, it is effectively treated by inhaler, and the inhaler delivers the drugs directly to the lungs, where the systemic absorption of the steroids or whatever medication we are going through, the inhalers are less, and causes effective symptom control and the disease control, and systemic side effect of the medications like steroids are avoided. By and large, now we treat the COPD and asthma with inhaled steroids without much of a long-standing side effects of the steroids. Sometimes we do use steroids, systemic steroids, but usually they are for a short term, and the short-term steroids give us the benefit and less likely to give the side effects for the long term.
So you mean to say we can take off steroids when it is not required in COPD?
Definitely.
The oral treatment or injectable steroids, we can take the patient off the steroid as early as possible, not like in asthma where you continue for a very long time.
Yes, in COPD, the role of COPD is role of steroids is very limited, and we can definitely come off the steroids as the patient's risk of exacerbation comes down. And now the mainstay of treatment in COPD is a bronchodilator, which are different from steroids.
So you spoke about treatment. Is there any role of vaccination? I think Dr. Sagar mentioned about post-infectious causes of COPD. So is there any role of some kind of a vaccination in COPD?
Yeah, as I was telling about my strategy to treat the COPD, preventing the exacerbations is an important strategy. Exacerbation means an acute attacks in the natural history of the COPD. To prevent them, we need to prevent the infections. And we have two vaccinations which are recommended, and with a sufficient evidence, which combinedly this a pneumococcal vaccine against the bacterial infections and an influenza vaccine which is against the influenza disease. Combined, these two vaccines combinedly reduce the chances of infection by 70%, which is a big plus for this group of patients.
So H1N1 is something which is always a scare to people. So when do you think we should vaccinate all our patients? Every patient comes and asks, when should I get vaccinated? What is the ideal time for vaccination for influenza in our setting, especially in a city like Bangalore?
H1N1 is also a type of influenza, and the peak of this influenza happens in the winter season. In our place of in our city, Bangalore, the peak continues till March and April. The right time for vaccination, I would suggest it will be something like September, October of every year, which would cover you for next 9 months, and we can go for a second vaccination later.
So it's every year vaccination?
Every year vaccination, yes.
And what about, you spoke about pneumococcal vaccination, how frequently do you advise your patients?
The schedule of the pneumococcal vaccine depends on the age at which the patient presents to you. If the patient presents to you at less than 65 years, we do something like a pneumovax, where you have the 23-valent vaccine, which needs to be repeated every 5 years. If a person presents to you after 65 years, there is something like a conjugated vaccine, which needs to be one injection, and after 12 weeks, we can repeat the 23-valent vaccine, and that completes the vaccination schedule.
So prevention is always better than cure. Let it be any disease. I think COPD also, it holds good. So do you advise any lifestyle modifications in patients who are at risk for COPD? Dr. Sagar?
Definitely, as Dr. Ranganath already mentioned, the COPD is a preventable disease. There are many important lifestyle changes which are definitely going to help in preventing the patients from the people from getting COPD, and also preventing the exacerbations in patients of COPD. So one of the important lifestyle modification would be in smokers to advise them to quit smoking and take the help of a psychiatrist or a de-addiction specialist to help the patient to get rid of smoking. And everybody knows how difficult it is to quit the nicotine addiction. And obviously there are many trained pulmonologists also, and also many psychiatric colleagues who know how to help the patients with quitting smoking. And one of the important thing is to talk to the patients about the benefits of quitting smoking and what are the harms the smoking is going to cause them if they continue. And the other important lifestyle changes are, like, especially in metros when they are traveling, better to use the mask, because patients spend a lot of time, like half an hour, 1 hour in traffic, and the amount of smoke they are going to inhale is too much. So better to use masks when they are spending time in the traffic. And also we talked about indoor air pollution, adequate ventilation, and if they are using biomass fuel and all, adequate
exhaust duct
should be kept in place so that the smoke doesn't collect inside the home. And even in the occupational exposures, adequate personal protective equipments and masks should be used. And the industry people, whoever the employers are there, they should provide adequate personal protective equipments to get rid of the smoke inhalation and all. And if at all the house is located in a polluted area, even the government should take adequate steps to curb the pollution. And also person who are dwelling there, better if the patient is there in such a dwelling, sometimes changing the home might decrease his symptoms also. And I think these are the few lifestyle. And also one important thing is diet plays an important role in treating COPD patients. So protein rich diet should be taken in COPD patients, because decrease in the muscle mass due to decreased exercise in COPD patients is one of the most important association we have seen in such patients. So protein-rich diet is very important, and also regular exercise. So because of breathlessness, there will be a lot of exercise limitation. So patient might get restricted to home or around the home, but whatever the lung reserve he has, in that we have to train them to do adequate exercises. Like there are few set of exercises which comes under something called pulmonary rehabilitation, where the patient can do exercise while sitting or with minimal exertion. There are few breathing exercises, isometric muscle training exercises are there, which will help the patient to increase his exercise capacities.
In nutshell, what you are trying to tell is try to avoid pollution.
Yeah.
And use alternate sources of energy, like you can use electric stoves and all, reduce the use of wood smoke.
Just to add one point to this discussion about the air pollution, especially indoor pollution. India is a city of villages. even now, around 65% of our Indian populations depend on wood for cooking their daily meals. And in states like Kashmir, we use the heater almost throughout the year to keep themselves warm. And there, actually, the compared to other states of the India, Kashmir has a higher incidence of COPD because of this reason. So there is an organization called Chest Research Foundation in Pune, which has done a lot of work on the field of COPD in terms of prevalence, incidence, risk factors, has given a simple suggestion like having a window in a kitchen, which actually would give a better ventilation and decreases the exposure of smoke to a person who is cooking, would take us a long way in decreasing the exposure and decreasing the COPD incidences. These are the small interventions which are done on a large scale and address these things, educate the people about this ventilation, and also using the agarbatti and those dhoop and those kind of things sensibly, and avoiding the exposure repeatedly can decrease the burden of COPD in the society at large.
So nowadays, whenever you switch on your television, one thing which you are seeing is air quality index, okay, especially in the northern part of India and national capital. So what is this air quality index? As doctors, do we have to create some awareness? Do we need to take some precautions? And how bad it is for our field? Can you just elaborate, Dr. Ranganath, on this?
Yeah, it's the need of our, increasingly the air pollution is reaching the alarming levels. So air quality index is an it's a rough guide to say what should be the level of particular pollutants are which is acceptable for human health. And many cities, particularly as Dr. Syed mentioned, in northern cities are crossed that safe limits long back. Something like there is a PM 2.5, which is a particulate matter which is of 2.5 size, micron size, which is easily gets into the lungs, gets deposited to deeper parts of the lungs and can cause a lot of damage to the lungs. And one of the important causes for COPD, which is being recognized, also predisposed to many infections and permanent damage to the lung, which can in turn later develops into a COPD. So yes, these air pollution, whether it is an indoor or outdoor, is increasingly becoming a bigger problem. And according to one study, though globally smoking still remains an important or the major cause of COPD, in countries like ours where the indoor pollution is huge and the outdoor pollution is not controlled, it's increasingly becomes the more important cause for COPD in our India.
It is said that children are the most vulnerable group. I think that's the reason all the schools and colleges are shut in Delhi nowadays. So what do you think exactly happens? What do these chemical compounds like nitrates and sulfates, which are a part of the combustion, do to our lungs? Do they hamper our development?
Yes.
And development?
Yes. It creates a kind of an inflammation which prevents the natural growth of the lung. And as I've already mentioning, the PM 2.5 is fine particles. The lungs have a capacity to filter off the materials which are more than 5 micron. This 2.5 micron thing which gets into deeper to the our lungs and initiates the inflammation, which actually causes a lot of damage, which prevents the growth. And that is the reason where the kids are affected thing, and their future growth of the lungs and their infections worsen their overall development.
So earlier it was said that, you know, this air pollution just causes COPD or asthma, worsens the asthma. But the literature says that, you know, it is no more true. It can cause systemic inflammation as well. So there are a lot of young people who are coming up with diabetes, blood pressure and cardiac diseases. So there has been studies which have linked that air pollution itself can cause or trigger these kind of chronic diseases. It is not only COPD or asthma, it is the chronic inflammation which can lead to lot of diseases in our body. So you spoke about prevention, Dr. Ranganathan spoke elaborately about the treatment, and it is a treatable disease, though all these things are there, but unfortunately it is not a curable disease. So, Dr. Ranganath, do you have any other option? And what else can we do when you have a patient where medical line of management has failed? Can you just put in a word?
As the famous adage goes, the prevention is better than cure. So we have a best chance in handling diseases by preventing it. And as we know, the important risk factor is smoking, quitting smoking, and avoiding the pollution as much as we can reduce the incidence of COPD. And once you are presented with the patient or you already developed COPD, what we can do is we can treat in the lines what we discussed already. There are certain conditions, there are certain stage where the medication becomes redundant and patient doesn't get better, and if the other condition, other comorbid conditions are okay and is fit, we have an option called lung transplantation, where the diseased lung can be taken, replaced with a normal lung, or the donor lung is an option. I'm sure, I mean, Dr. Syed, this is your area, your expertise, and you can add more if
so
you want
to. Lung transplants for all chronic diseases, including COPD. This is done usually when chances of a person surviving for the next 2 years is less than 50%. Patient should be quite symptomatic, and when we have exhausted all the resources, medical line of management, including oxygen therapy and non-invasive ventilation, has failed to bring the patient back to a normal life. At least patient should be independent and should be less symptomatic. When these criteria is met, we consider lung transplant. I think Bangalore, we are doing lung transplant, and a lot of other centers in Tamil Nadu are doing lung transplant. So we had an elaborate discussion about what is COPD, why do we need to create awareness about COPD. We spoke about pollution levels, how pollution causes COPD. One final thing I want to ask Dr. Sagar is, what is this N95 mask? Okay, it's there in media everywhere. I think it is shown in most of the social media. What is this N95 mask?
So N95 mask is a specialized kind of mask. Usually, the other mask usually used is the something called surgeon's mask, which is readily available in all the medical stores, and few people will be selling it on the traffic signals also in polluted areas in metros and all. So usually those kind of simple masks may not prevent very fine particulate matter and also few of the infective particles like influenza viruses and bacteria, and also in chronic diseases like tuberculosis, even the tubercular bacteria may pass through these pores of these masks and infect the people. So when we are treating a patient or to the nearest family members, the patient who is affected with something very infective bacteria or virus, so better for the family member and also the patient to use this mask called N95 mask, which will prevent even the very very small microorganisms and also the particulate matter to
in the context of existing situation where AQI has gone worse. I think what Dr. Sagar is trying to tell is N95 mask, 95 stands for 95% of PM2.5, which Dr. Ranganath mentioned. This particulate matter, when it is 2.5 or less, it is very harmful. So when 95% filtration rate is there in this N95 mask, that's why we advise this N95 mask. As he said, it is useful for viruses and bacteria also. So, Dr. Ranganath, do you have any message? You have a vast experience of treating COPD, asthma and other respiratory diseases. So, as a senior faculty, do you have any message to the public?
It's clear now by this discussion that it's the COPD poses an enormous stress on the healthcare society at large. And it takes a lot of healthcare budget and puts a lot of stress on the individual house's budget when the family has a COPD patient. So the global organization called Global Initiative for Chronic Obstructive Lung Diseases, we call it as GOLD, and observes every day World COPD Day, just to increase the awareness of these kind of things. I mean, about the COPD and the risk factors and the ways to cope with this kind of a menace. So, as the adage goes, it is prevention is better than cure. So, what we have to do is educate the family, educate the society at large about the harmful effects of the smoking and air pollution, and stay away from these things. And if you come across a patient with COPD, please don't lose hope. It is treatable, and the complications can be prevented, and we can make their life comfortable, and we have means to treat them well, and we have now the means where the diseased lungs can be exchanged. So there is a lot of hope in treating these conditions. I would say increase the awareness, and when you come across the case of COPD, be compassionate and treat the condition, and we can make a difference. The theme of this year's World COPD Day is all together. We can all together make a difference.
I thank Dr. Ranganath for sparing his valuable time, and Dr. Sagar for his valuable inputs on this COPD disease. And I thank Narayana for organizing this interactive session on COPD.
Thank you.